So what exactly is universal health coverage? Well, it's an idea, and it's a powerful idea, and here it is. Imagine a world in which all people can access the healthcare services they need to either stay healthy or improve their health without suffering financial hardship. So what's not to like, right? It's the kind of idea that you can get behind regardless of your political ideology or leaning. You don't even need to be Canadian to get excited about universal health coverage. So let's unpack this a little bit. Think of universal health coverage as a pooled fund, and this pooled fund can come from a variety of sources. So it can come from general government budget, it can come from compulsory insurance contributions, and it can come from voluntary health insurance. And then these funds get used to address the three dimensions of universal health coverage. And these three dimensions are, number one, the proportion of people covered, number two, the proportion of costs covered, and number three, the range of services that are available. And of course, policymakers need to make decisions, and of course, they need to make trade-offs between these dimensions. And they make those trade-offs in a way that maximizes the extent to which people's healthcare needs are met and avoids catastrophic healthcare expenses that can lead to impoverishment. And so the idea of universal health coverage is really that it's an idea that is in contrast to its alternative. And the alternative is that healthcare is just another good or service that can be dealt with in the marketplace. Now, there are some goods and services, and in fact, most goods and services for which the marketplace is excellent. Healthcare is just not one of them. So the price and quantity of iPhones that get bought and sold, fine. Works really well in the marketplace, leave it there. But there are circumstances and there are goods and services for which markets tend to fail. And healthcare happens to be one of the best examples of this. Now, I'm going to create an entire separate video that gets into the economic theory as to why it is that healthcare markets tend to fail. And in that video, I'm going to talk about things like adverse selection, information asymmetry, externalities, and supplier-induced demand. All you really need to know for now is that the economic theory predicts that healthcare markets will fail. And the empiric evidence, the data, the natural experiment that's really been done in the world confirms just that. A healthcare system that relies too heavily on private healthcare service provision is not only extraordinarily expensive, and the empiric evidence demonstrates that, but also at a population level produces very poor health outcomes, and the evidence and the data support that conclusion as well. Now, I'm not saying that there's anything wrong with private healthcare services. I have private healthcare insurance, but I'm delighted to live in a country where if I were to lose my job or fall into financial difficulty, that my family wouldn't be in harm's way. And if I feel that way, how much more must it be the case for small business owners and entrepreneurs who really form the backbone of the economy? In fact, universal health coverage is arguably one of the best things that you can do to encourage the entrepreneurial spirit and to grow the economy and create jobs. But of course, that's not the reason why it's a beautiful idea. The beautiful thing about universal health coverage is that it protects the poor and the vulnerable and prevents people from falling into poverty. In the US, for example, the number one reason for going into poverty is unforeseen healthcare expenses. Now, of course, the scope of services that any given country can afford to offer its people is a function of what that country can afford. And so a lot of thought needs to go into identifying the most cost-effective combination of services to meet the needs of people, given the financial constraints that all countries work within. And DCP3 supports just that kind of decision-making. What is DCP3? Well, I'm glad you asked. DCP3 stands for Disease Control Priorities, 3rd edition. It's a 9-volume series. It promotes the use of economic evaluation for priority setting for across the world, especially in developing countries. DCP3 has been developed by experts in health from across the world, and it's been led by a team at the University of Washington's Department of Global Health. Find out more at dcp3.org or click on the link in the description below. And incidentally, DCP3 are sponsoring this video, so a big thank you to them from me. And by the way, this actually works. I mean, we've seen countries from across the income spectrum, from Ethiopia to Indonesia to Thailand to France, implementing the principles of universal health coverage. And countries that make progress towards universal health coverage see, no surprise, improvements in health outcomes and reductions in catastrophic healthcare spending. Now, stay and watch another video and subscribe to this channel if you haven't already. A big thank you to those of you that are supporting this channel through patreon.com. I really appreciate it. Couldn't do it without you. And a huge thank you to DCP3 for sponsoring this video. Click on the link in the description below if you want to find out more. Take care. Please hang up and try again.